just the beginning. Go ahead, Strata.
Here it comes.
Let's go fuck some people up on the freeway. Oh, they're in the carpool lane right now, stunting on everybody on the 405.
Nice.
Oh, what a show.
Subscribe to our YouTube if you're not. Please, please, please. It's very good. It's the best kept secret on YouTube.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely a secret right now.
Yeah. Let's expose it.
Let's go.
Tell a friend.
Full bag of chicken nuggets, 20 double cheeseburgers, 20 McChickens along with a bag of Reese's Peanut Butter Cup McFlurry Mix out the drive-thru window an hour before closing two nights a week. Then we get baked up after work and plenty of food for everybody. Okay, that I posted to Twitter on the $20 Chef and retweeted it from my page. I think you retweeted it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you currently or have worked a drive-thru, how much and how did you hook the homies up? Did they say a certain thing to let you know it was them, and then they got a bag of free food? And that was one of the first dudes who piped in, bro. That's what he gave away, dude. A full bag of nuggets. That's got to be 100 nuggets. I mean, a 50-piece, that's got to be a fucking 100 nuggets.
It's got to be.
Okay? And 20 double cheeseburgers, 20 McChickens.
20 McChickens. I mean, that place is going to go bankrupt.
This guy gave away the house, bro. I don't know. I just randomly thought of it. I mean, I was at McDonald's and I was like, what if I had a homie that worked here? I wonder what the hookup would be. You know?
Right. Yeah.
Because I never had a drive. Like, I've always had my hookups are always at bars or like corporate restaurants.
Right.
So I never had the hookup at a drive thru. And I mean, we gave away the house at corporate restaurants. We used to trade. I used to call up when I became assistant manager at Chevy's. I'd call up the other restaurants. I'd be like, hey, what's up? This is Sean, manager over at Chevy's. Yeah. I was wondering if you guys wanted to do some trade for lunch.
Yeah, like, why not?
Yeah, hold on. No problem. Let me get the hostess. You just go ahead and tell what you want. And I'm like, all right. You can send over, you know, you can tell us what you want. And right. Then that was it. And then the hostesses, we would send the hostess to go get it and do the like, hey, Alice, do me a favor. There's just a go order in the window. Can you run that over to Black Eyed Peas and then just bring back another order? He created a fucking water softener system at his house.
That's incredible. I knew trade like that goes on all the time with people who own businesses.
At the corporate level, yeah, it's on. Just
between employee to employee, like, fuck it, let's do this.
The manager has the little comp card, dude, the GM.
Yeah.
Oh, man, bro. There's some good ones in here. I think that this one might run, bro. This thread might go bonkers. Because, I mean, people are... this guy said he worked delivering furniture with a guy who ran a Sonic. He'd double beep him on his Nextel, and the guy'd call and take the order and run it to the back door. The man burger was the beef, chicken, beef, three times cheese topped with tots and chili on a bun. Oh, man. I gave away the house, though. I gave away the house.
I mean, I only worked at one restaurant my whole life. I worked at two. I worked at a Pizza Hut for a little while, but... I worked at the mom and pop pizza restaurant that was literally right behind my house. So our backyard touched the railroad tracks. This is after we moved away from the farm. We lived in this little town. Our backyard backed up to the railroad tracks. And the other side of the railroad tracks was the little mom and pop pizza shop called Pizza Plus. And I worked there my senior year with one of my best friends, and we ran the joint. Like we were so good at what we did. Like the owner just would put us two on, and we'd alternate delivering versus cooking and working inside. So on a Friday night, man, our friends would call in. We were like, all right, just call in what pizzas you want, like four of them or whatever. Yeah. And but use a different name. So we wrote out the ticket, you know. So every night, every Friday night, we'd all meet at my buddy Jim's house and come back with like four pizzas for everybody. You know, we're like, I don't know, the people just never showed up to get them. So we just wrote them off.
That's beautiful, man. Oh, that's so fun. Yeah. I mean, not for the business owner, but I think we've mentioned it before. I never jacked the mom and pop spot, just the corporate spots. Eh?
Yeah. But I mean, like that pizza costs like,
oh yeah, no. I'm saying like that's nothing.
Yeah.
I'm talking about all the shit that I did, you know, the high dollar stuff.
Oh yeah.
Like sure. A few fucking pizzas, whatever. But yeah. Cause it's dough. It's like dough and like $4 worth of pepperoni.
Right.
You know, I mean, dough, it's fucking water, flour, and egg.
I remember a buddy of mine in high school. He worked loss prevention for Lazarus, I think it was. This, you know, they still have Lazarus. I don't know if they still have them or not. But anyway, like a high-end retail place in the mall. And he was a loss prevention guy. He was supposed to be there to keep employees and customers from stealing. And this motherfucker robbed that place blind. He would always come to school and he would sell watches and like Oakley sunglasses and shit, like Guess watches, Oakley sunglasses, and just sell them fucking cheap as hell. But, you know, he fucking stole them all. I guarantee you. I mean, he had a side business going, like he was making good jack in school. So they were, I don't know at what point they had to catch up. Like, fuck, dude, we were supposed to have 50 new Oakley sunglasses. There's only 30 in there. Like, how many times can that happen before you get fucking fired? But this dude would come in with a new haul like once a month and just unload.
I can't wait for that post to eat. Like, people are going to come out of the woodworks to talk about it, bro.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man, that's going to be good, dude. That's going to be good.
You know, I had another miss. Thank God this didn't happen because I was just young and dumb. But now my best friend was working at a gas station, kind of in the hood, you know? Mm-hmm. And he was like that same guy that worked loss prevention for Lazarus that ripped them off. He came up with a plan. Like Mike was talking about the closing procedures and stuff and how much cash they'd have or whatever. And Mike was like, oh, shit, I just said his first name. Anyway, he goes, we can go there. Todd and I can go there and just come in and you just hand us all the money. And then like 15 minutes later, just call in you got robbed and just, you know, give different descriptions of the people and the wrong description of the car and stuff. And nobody will know. Because he was like, well, our cameras aren't working right now. And we seriously,
how much cash?
I might have been like $500, $700 or something. Yeah. And we thought we were big time. We were going to pull this heist. And then something happened and the Mike's schedule got screwed up or something on that night. So we didn't end up doing it. And then afterward, we were like, no, we shouldn't do that. Like, well, how stupid were we? There's no way we would have got away with that. They would have put Mike in the sweat box. He would have fucking ratted out all of us. We'd all got arrested at 17 years old for robbing a gas station.
And your life would have been a complete opposite direction.
It would have been ruined. Ruined.
Yep.
Jesus. The dumb things you think about.
Dude, it's going to be easy, bro.
Yeah.
Easy. I'll just say
it was two Hispanic dudes, one 7 foot tall and the other 3 foot tall. You know, like, oh, God, so dumb.
Man, that's wild. It is. Well, dude, I tell you, one time I was so hard up in L.A., I was like, I needed money so bad. And I was at a point where I was looking and looking and jobs and everything and all this wasn't happening. I don't know if I said on this show, but I went and bought a toy gun and I painted it black. And I was like, I got to rob somebody in an alley. Like, I have no choice.
Holy shit.
And Yeah, bro. So I got it. I was driving around Venice Beach. Like, I got it. I'm going to fucking, like, my life, I'm going to be homeless. And I was, oh my God, everything, dude, that was, I drove around for like probably 3 hours, bro, trying to figure out if I should do it. Who would be the, like, looking. And then I just drove away. I couldn't do it.
Oh, thank God.
Couldn't do it. Can you imagine? I just was like, yeah, because what if they had a fucking gun or something? Like, yeah. There's a million things that can go wrong.
Oh.
But I was just, that's the moment of desperation I was in.
Yeah.
And I just fucking nothing. Yeah. And then I feel like the next day or the day after, something major happened. I can't remember what it was. Something like majorly positive in my life.
Yeah.
And I was just like, Jesus, bro. If that would have went wrong, because I think that probably would have went wrong and I would have gotten in trouble, because 2 days later, some really good shit happened.
Right. There's like a little angel on your shoulder came down and just whispered in your ear, don't do it. Don't do it.
Yeah.
And then this thing was right around the corner.
That was probably like 2008, I'd say. Yeah, I'd say 2008.
Wow.
I remember buying it, had a ski mask, fucking beanie.
Oh, no.
I was going to be full movies, bro. I'm like, well, I never robbed nobody. I'm like, I just got to do what they do in the movies. Put on a fucking ski mask, and here's my gun, kid.
Give me your money. What if you would have killed fucking Batman's parents? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
well, it was a toy gun, so I couldn't.
Oh, that's true. Shit, that's true.
Yeah, I would have just got caught slipping like a fucking Momo.
Right. God. Yeah. What if it was the wrong person and they were like, fucking, mm-hmm. They pulled out a gun or something, or even just fought back and then shit went wrong, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And then I get fucking arrested.
Like the person has a heart attack. What if the person had a heart attack and died right there? Mm-hmm. It's like, fuck, so many things could have went wrong.
Yeah, dude. That was a rough one. You know, in LA, shit got rough a few times.
Yeah. It is weird, though, when you get desperate. It's like, what am I going to do? It's this or fucking, you know?
Yeah.
Not eat, not fucking be out on the street.
Jesus. Yeah. So I'm going to have to rack my brain and look at that time frame. What I got that year, comedy-wise, because it was that close. And it was that. I mean, I remember I was just driving around and fucking... I'd see people. I'd be right. You know, I would roll up kind of like, but I couldn't do it. I just didn't have it in me.
Yeah.
Didn't have it.
My luck, I would like got the one guy that had like $2 on him. And then I would have committed this robbery for $2. Never mind, man. I'm just kidding. It's fake.
Nah,
just kidding. It's made out of licorice. It's not real.
You know, the reason I thought of it, I remember I had this one friend who he was really kind of like a reformed gangster.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that, they used to do it all the time. They you know, stick up kids.
Right.
They just roll around fucking just sticking people up. But like there'd be three or four of them doing it at once, you know? And so he said 95% of the time, motherfuckers just freeze up, dude. They don't know what to do. They're just like, so that's when I was like, well, I mean, I got a 95% chance a motherfucker just going to freeze up.
Oh, yeah. I think that's mostly what I thought, do, right? Mostly they do. Yeah. But
that's what he said.
Yeah. There's that one time. It only takes once. You get some fucking.
You know what? One day I'm gonna, because I still, you know, I'm still friends with him. I haven't seen him in years, but I'm gonna hit him up and be like, "Yo, would you ever want to just tell stories, bro, about your shit you did?"
Yeah, why not? That'd be interesting to hear, man.
Just I have this from fucking street level criminal.
I know. See, I have this cousin, and he's been in and out of prison. He's getting ready to go back. It sounds like now, and this is probably his fifth trip. All the in-between times, you know, he just ends up homeless and strung out. And he's been all over the country being homeless and strung out and getting arrested. And do I even want to hear the stories? Probably, because I'm into shit like that. But like, why? I just think about everything that he's gone through. He's definitely probably robbed people. At least strong-armed. He's a big, strong dude. So, you know, he's definitely done that. You know, what all shit has gone down in order to survive on the streets for as long as he have, because he's done it. God, he's only 4 or 5 years younger than me, and he's done this pretty much off and on since he was in his early 20s.
You know, I have a cousin, too, that I could do that with, but I refuse to give that part of a, like, I'm not cool with them, any of them. One of them didn't do as much. he was responsible for terrorizing my family and my grandparents and, you know, my mom's intermediate. But if I didn't have such animosity to him for wrecking so much of my family in the past, mm-hmm. then I would do it. But see, I don't know what York, like, I just know that this guy, like, had my grandmother putting their house up for bail type shit. You know what right. I mean?
Well, no, he was like,
so I don't
like,
know if, yeah,
his mom's gone broke because of him, you know, like, and she had a bunch of money at one point. He's just, with lawyer fees alone, that shit, you know, cost you what, 30 grand to have your kid represented in a halfway decent manner, at least yeah. 30 grand. I mean, on big time felony cases, you know, like, mm-hmm. I have the same feeling. And like, I'll get calls from him every time he gets locked up. I'll get a call from the prison. It's got one probably a month ago, you know, from an inmate.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I'm not taking that. And then he gets in the cycle. He'll just keep calling and keep calling and keep calling and just not stop. So I finally, like in the fifth one, it said, if you want to, and then I start getting texts from the jail. That's like, that's new. They can pay to text and you can reverse the charges. So I hit no. And it said, if you want to block any calls or texts from this correctional facility, just hit here. So I did. That was new. Cause before he would just burn my shit up. And one time I had to call the jail. I was still a cop then. I called the jail and I was like, hey, I got to stop these calls. You know, he won't stop. And I keep blocking it, but it cycles to a different number or whatever. So they were like, oh no, we can enter in the system. And they blocked me that way. But
oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. But I was like, what the fuck? And then as soon as he gets out, he would hit me on his cell phone, like when he needed money and I would try to talk to him the first couple times, but you know, he's all strung out and talking crazy. And I'm just like, nope, got to delete it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a block. I hate that because I love that kid, but you know what I mean? We grew up together almost like brothers, but the fuck?
Nothing you can do about it. Nothing you can do. Like if a motherfucker picks a direction, you know, we ain't all going down that direction.
I know.
And when you're younger, the stronghold of like the family, you know, it consumes you more. Like you almost feel like you're trapped because you can't help. And then you start talking to yourself about how I could help. And then you make it like it's okay to do it. You know, like, and next thing you know, this person's got you doing shit and you just don't even think it's not. And you just could think it's okay.
Oh, I know.
Because of that, just that whole, listen, I know family's important, right? And friendships and all that, but people get so skewed when motherfuckers start asking them to do things that will literally change their own life.
Mm-hmm.
Where they're like letting that whole, again, I don't know, a blanket of quote unquote family and we're from togetherness to like suck you in. They use that as a tool.
Oh yeah.
You know, I watched my cousins do it my entire life, you know? And like now these motherfuckers, they don't get it that I don't consider you like we come from the same tree of human genetics, but that doesn't mean that I have to like you. I don't need you in my life, buddy.
Oh, I know, man. And like when I was a young cop and he was first starting to get in trouble, I remember like one time, and I should have done this, but then I still had hope for the kid, you know? So his mom calls me and says, hey, Chris is in this crack house with this dude. She said the name and I knew the name. And I was like, God damn it. And I was like, that's a bad dude. And she was like, yeah, I know. And I'm just worried. Is there any way you can go over there and get him? And, you know, I don't want to put you in a bad situation, whatever. And I'm like, oh, Jesus. I've only been on like a year and a half. Like, I'm losing my job over this kid or whatever. So I called one of my buddies and I go, listen, I got to do something kind of off the books. I got to go over there and grab my cousin out of this crack house. And I said, this is the dude's place. And he's like, oh, are you serious? And I was like, yeah. And he goes, all right, I'll ride with you. And I was like, all right, well, just stay in the car. I didn't give you any information. If anything comes back on it, I just asked you to ride with me. Mm-hmm. So he rides with me. I pull up to this trailer and I go in there and there's like fucking 20 crackheads in this fucking trailer. Wow. And I just walk in the door. I didn't even knock anything. I just opened the door and I walked in and I have, you know, police shit on and they're just all looking at me like half are paying attention, half are scared to death. or half aren't paying attention, half are scared to death. So I walked through the back and I'm like, where's Chris at? Where's Chris at? Where's Chris at? And they pointed toward the very back room. And I go to the back room and he's in there with the dude. And I just pulled this curtain. It was just separated by a curtain, this back bedroom was. And
you in full uniform?
No, but I had police shit on. So you can tell. Okay. I had like a jacket. Yeah. And I pointed at Chris and I go, get off the bed. Let's go. And the other guy gets up and goes, well, who the fuck do you think? And he starts starting shit. And I'm like, ah, oh, this is where it goes bad, right? Like he's not scared. And he's going to try to fight me or something. This is where shit goes bad. And I was thinking, oh my God. So I just pointed at him and I go, sit the fuck back down, John. And he was like, or what, motherfucker? And I go, or you don't leave this trailer. And he was like, oh, fuck you. And I was like, this is a bluff, but I got to go for it. And I just looked, I stared at him and I go, I will bury you in this back fucking yard. And if I have to fucking get rid of every fucking crackhead witness in here to do so, I'll do it. And I'll set this motherfucker on fire. And
wow.
And he was like, and yeah, it kind of scared him a little bit. He's like, oh, okay, well, we'll see. But he sat back down and I just walked out. And I put Chris in the car and I just fucking punched him as hard as I could in his chest. I was like, whoo. And I was like, you motherfucker, you just almost cost me everything in there. If that guy had to back down, shit would have gone bad. I'll get fired. I still might get fired if that motherfucker doesn't play ball. And he was all crying and everything. I'm like, never again. So I told his aunt, I was like, never again. I cannot, or told my aunt, I'm like, I can never do this again. Like, yep, it was too close. Shit almost went bad. I'm trying, you know, I'll lose my whole fucking career. And I never did it again after that. But here I am trying to play crazy, like a fucking movie cop. Like,
Oh my God, I'll burn this whole trailer full of crackheads, motherfucker. Yeah, that's awesome.
That is I didn't know what to say. I was like, I have to scare him at this point. Like, he has to believe me. It's almost like dirty cop. I feel bad about even saying it, but I was like, oh, fuck. Oh, just trying to get my shit, cousin, man, out of there.
Hey, you guys listen to the Guns Blazing podcast. We're back into this message. Oh, wait a second. I forgot we don't do commercials, dude. That would be like perfect to go to a commercial with such a good story. And I'm like, I forgot we don't do commercials. Sometimes I fall back into radio, Todd. My radio brain takes over and I go into commercial when there's not even one.
But what if we did could do commercials? What would we do? Oh, probably preferred maybe to our old friends at 3Chi. If this was a commercial spot, it's
yep,
not.
Yep, yep.
But let's say it was a commercial spot. We might try to inform the listener about 3Chi because they're actually friends of ours now. And we love
them. They are, Todd.
Very much. I don't know if you've heard of 3Chi, listeners, but it's spelled 3CHI, the number 3CHI. Just think of it like a really good pizza, 3Chi's. They're the industry leader in Delta 8 THC products, and all their products are formulated by biochemists. Like, this is a legitimate.
Hello.
And all products.
Biochemists.
Not only by biochemists, but they're made right here in the USA with USA grown hemp, formulated by biochemists right here in the USA with USA grown hemp. Sean, I don't think it gets any more American than that.
I don't think people really understand what we're talking about. We're talking about United States of America hemp.
Delta 8, baby.
Delta 8, federally legal version of THC. Two words come to mind when I'm thinking 3Chi, Todd, and I'll tell you what those are. Comfortably numb, friend. Comfortably numb. Because that's what's going on here.
Because I tell you what, it works. This is unbelievable. I mean, a federally legal version of THC, and it feels I get all the positive attributes as I do from like the Delta 9 that's not legal everywhere yet. But you know what I noticed, Sean? I get none of the negatives. You know what I mean? I get no.
I'll tell you what. Are you talking about anxiety or laziness or paranoia or mental fogginess?
That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Dude, that's what I don't get anymore.
It's amazing, right?
It's mind-blowing.
I mean, Delta 8 users report feeling more active and outgoing with increased confidence and almost none of this anxiousness or paranoia associated with the Delta 9 usage. And we both experience the same thing.
And you know, I'm gonna be real honest with you. I didn't think I'd be able to admit this, but I've been skipping lately. Like, I haven't skipped in years. I'm light in my feet. I'm comfortably numb. I don't have no anxiety. I was skipping, Todd, in the snow.
Sean, I was watching a movie on Netflix. I stopped, went into the kitchen, and started cleaning the kitchen while whistling. I was very wispy in nature after taking the 3-2.
There you go. There goes Todd. Look at him. Happy, go lucky, pumped, cleaning, motivated.
Whistling while I worked. It's the federally legal version of THC, and it's more functional alternative to marijuana for those who want the same great feelings without the negative side effects. You'll feel amazing, yet functional and clear-headed instead of lazy and paranoid. It's just the best. 3-Chi is the best in the Delta 8 industry. And, you know, we even hate to say that, Sean, because as you well know, they invented the industry.
Yeah, they're not part of the industry. They're not a large part of the industry. There was no industry. And then what they did was, it's called a breakthrough. They smashed through a wall with a product. It's kind of like being Weed THC's little brother, like doing all the stuff that he did to make him popular, but then he toned it back to the right way to make it legal.
That's exactly what it was. And there, you got to be 21 to purchase it. Like that immediately, I was like, this is too good to be true. I'm not sure this is legit. I mean, it sounds legit with everything else. And I definitely am experiencing everything that they promised I would experience. But is it really legit? And then, boom, I see the disclaimer, must be 21 to purchase.
Look, regular CBD, a baby can take. Okay. This ain't that. This is the real deal. That you got to be 21 to drink. You got to be 21 for 3-Chi. And that's because it's real. This ain't no bullshit.
Yeah, because it's a good time. Anything that's a really good time requires you to be 21 to do it.
Yeah, and guess what? Right now, we're hooking everybody up.
Uh-oh.
Hit the hookup sound. We don't have one, but here's the...
We need a hookup sound.
Because this is the hookups coming. Here comes the hookup. Put a train noise. Put a train noise in right here, because guess what? The hookup right now, 5% off if you use promo code GUNS. That's G-U-N-S. GUNS.
You can shop for the Delta 8 vapes, gummies, tinctures, and oils at 5% off. Come on. Come on.
Hello. Maybe you want to, maybe you don't like the snacks that they offer. Well, guess what? All you need to do is pick up some 3-Chi oils, and you can make any food you want become this product.
Oh God, is there any way
edibles. Hello, is this thing on? Hello. Hello.
I mean, how could this get any better? It can't. It can't. You got the information. Do with it what you will. But if you like supporting this podcast, you might as well support the best sponsor we've ever had in our history of entertaining people on a microphone. 3-Chi. CHI.com. Promo code GUNS. Visit them on Twitter as well. At 3-Chi CBD. On Instagram, same. Facebook, same. All right. Boom. God, I love them, man.
I almost skipped right out of the goddamn podcast studio right now. So pumped.
I mean, there are some sponsors who have been like, hey, listen, Sean and Todd, a little edgy. We're giving this a little time before we commit because these guys like to toe a line. Yeah, we like to toe a line. A line of being real.
Guess what? Guess who can't toe lines? People who don't understand the proper balance and they have clumsy feet. We toe lines because we know what we're doing. Exactly. It's hard for you. Guess what? You, it's hard. Mm-hmm. For me, for Todd, easy.
Easy. And 3-Chi gets it. They're like, you know what? We're on board. We're on board for the long haul. We love you, 3-Chi.
I'm starting to wonder if the cats got into my 3-Chi, because these cats upstairs are fucking, it sounds like I got someone living above me, bro. And it's 2 9-pound cats.
Are they whistling?
They're like, what is going on? Stuff's moving around and shit, bro. What are these guys up to?
If they start organizing shit and humming and having a good time while they're doing it, then yes, they have. Because
if I see a cat skip down these stairs, I'm going to know that's a goddamn clear-headed cat with no anxiety, and he's not feeling lazy. He must have gotten that 3-Chi.
It would be amazing to see a cat skip because they got to synchronize both sets of legs at the same time in the skipping motion. I would lose my mind.
Is that what deer do?
It's kind of is, right?
They get that. Is that what they do? Yeah, but I mean, technically, it's a four hoof skip. Like we wouldn't be able to skip so easy with you without two hoofs.
I know. I feel like I would. I would screw it up. I would be like, oh, I'm perfectly skipping with my back legs, but my front legs are kind of stopping me, knocking me off momentum. But maybe when you have four appendages, it automatically, well, we have four appendages, but if you have four legs, they all operate in they're synchronized like how both our two legs are.
Yeah. And I also feel like we should have like hoof week where like we call all animals hoofs feet and then we call our feet hoofs.
Oh, yeah. If I could have, all right, so let's say you could have hooves, right? For one, you save so much money on shoe wear, right?
Oh, man.
Especially you.
Trek through the mud, the dirt, the water, the grass.
It doesn't hurt your feet. You could be out like you've seen horses. You seen deer? They don't give a fuck.
There comes Sean. You see how nice that'd be?
Yeah. I mean, they don't care if it's the road. They don't care if it's wet and it's slimy and swampy. They don't care if it's snow. They don't care if it's loose gravel. It doesn't affect them at all. Hooves would be coming but we would have to like, because we're humans, we would have to jazz up our hooves. Then it would become a henna tattoo, like you would design, you know, I put a swoosh on my hoof. I just go.
I might like kind of like file out a little bit, a little section where I could put like a Swiss Army knife in there.
Oh, that would be cool. Right.
Obviously I'm going to shine my hoofs up. I'm going to get nice shiny hooves. You know, it's like being born with work boots on, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's what it's like. It's like, hey, wah, wah, what do I got to do? Where do I clock in? You know what I mean?
I would kick the fuck out of people, too. I would join MMA. If I was the only human with hooves, it would be discrimination if they kept me out of MMA. Mm-hmm. I would just slice dude's shins wide open. Can you imagine?
You'd have to start a movement, the fighters with hooves. Have rights to movement.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I have a hoof. I'm sorry. What am I supposed to not fight?
Right.
You let the guy that doesn't have a hoof at all. He just the leg and hoof is gone. He gets to fight.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it okay for him to fight with all full appendage missing, but not when I have something added on? It's both natural either way.
Mm-hmm. That's why I'm looking at it. I mean, these hoofs are grown from my legs. They're not artificial hooves. I say if I put on fake hooves, kick me out.
You can find me. People can tell a fake hoof. People can tell it's not a real hoof.
So women, if they had hoofs, they would have to paint the hoofs, right?
Well, I think they would have little shops where like buckets of paint. They just go in there and dip their hoofs in.
Oh yeah, it's just a hoof dip situation.
Yeah, a hoof dip.
Hey Julie, you wanna go get our hooves dipped?
I got you a little gift card. Someone's going to get their hooves dipped this week. Guess who? You are, Julie.
You could bling them out. Like you would just get like the like little like tacks, you know, that have like gold beaded ends. And you would just like hammer them into the hooves and designs.
Well, in the 80s, a lot of people did splatter paint hoofs. People don't really forget that. It was a big deal back then.
That's true.
You know, they would get the sunglasses with the splatter paint. That's what I'd buy them at the swap meet, the splatter paint sunglasses. They were kind of a big deal.
They were.
And I assume people doing the same thing with their hoofs.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. God, I wish we were centaurs. That'd be the shit.
You know what would happen? You know what would happen, though? Yeah, that would have been nice, bro. Really pick up some speed, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Really get some speed going. Still have operations of the hands to fire off rounds.
Oh, yeah.
That's what no one's doing. They're not... The centaur hasn't really adapted with the technologies like we have as a humanity. Every time I see a centaur, if he's not doing an Old Spice commercial, he's still holding on to a bow and arrow.
Right.
Like, come on.
Give
him automatic rifles, bro. He's a horse, bro. He can haul nuts. He's a fucking weapon. Give him some guns. Put somebody on his back. Why aren't people riding these things?
I mean, give him an AK. Put a saddle on his back so another dude can jump on there, run a 50 cal.
Yeah.
He doesn't even have to steer. Like, he can just sit up there.
Can you imagine if a car in the drive-by can also be a part of the drive? Like, can you imagine if the car, the Cutlass, that's full of gangsters about to do a drive-by, if the actual car could also hold a piece and unload while it drove? That's what a Centaur is, exactly. With a guy on the back. Why don't we do our own TV show where it's all about Centaur Wars? You got the fucking old school versus the new school. Why isn't this a thing? Hello, Hollywood? It's Sean and Todd.
Why do we not have more Centaur buddy movies? We could be cops. We'd be the coolest buddy cops. We're just two centaurs working all the parades. Instead of the cops on horseback, it's just us. Yeah.
Nobody needs a cop meeting a horse. Okay, right. That's too many working parts.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get the police centaurs. They're the guy. No more. If you're not a fucking horse and a cop at the same time, if you're not actually half of your horse, then go get on a bike or something, like whatever. And yeah. That brings me to another question.
Mm-hmm.
When you're a bike cop, is that like the low on the totem pole? Like, is that where you come in and they're like, all right, everybody's a bike cop until we fucking decide who gets cars?
It should be. Those guys are awful proud of their motorcycles, and you're like,
No. Not motorcycle cops.
Mm-hmm.
Bike cops. Bicycle. Oh,
the bicycle cops.
Yeah. Motorcycle cops, I would think, are above the car guys. Those, they get to have the choice of the motorcycle.
I mean, they think they're pretty shit hot. I have a different opinion because I'm like, oh, you're just writing tickets. But the bicycle cops, that's hilarious, right? You have to spend like 3 years as a bicycle cop before you can be a motorcycle cop. That would be fucking hilarious.
I mean, that every time you, if you ever, I mean, the show Chips, man, that was just an unbelievable fucking show. I mean, when that fucking sound came on, hold on, just the beginning. Go ahead, Strata. Here it comes. Let's go fuck some people up on the freeway. Oh, they're in the carpool lane right now, stunting on everybody on the 405.
Nice.
Oh, what a show. God damn, that was beautiful, dude.
Oh, I love that show. I wanted to be Poncherella so bad.
Me too, bro. I love John and Ponch, bro. I could look like Ponch kind of if I did the fucking hair top. I parted it.
Oh, for sure.
If I trained it and cut it, I could get, and I slimmed down some and I got rid of the beard. Mm-hmm. I started chewing gum from the back of my mouth.
Yeah.
I could have been Ponch, bro.
They were cool. I like, and they
honestly, we are basically a fucking 2020 version of fucking Ponch and John.
We should be recreating it.
Did we just have a fucking breakthrough right now that we are Ponch and John?
Yeah. We are the new Ponch and John. Jesus Christ.
Ponch and John, bro.
I just know.
I started to look around the room like there was a live audience and they were all going to be in on it. But guess what? I'm by myself. It's me in this room by myself and you're over there.
But you're right. Oh my God. I didn't even think about all this time. That's probably why we've always gotten along so well. We were like the fucking
Ponch and John, dude. You're my John.
Jesus.
Everybody. That makes so much sense now.
I mean, I know not everybody knows who Ponch and John are, but I feel like most of you should because they just remade a movie not too long ago with fucking
Eric Estrada?
No, the new one, the movie.
Well, they just redid Chips, huh? They did those pigs.
Yeah, it was, but no, but we're like them in real life. This is
We are.
Dak. Why is my brain not working?
Dax Shepard and Michael Pena.
Yes.
There it is.
Yeah.
Michael fucking Pena, the most, he's the Mexican right now. We get one.
He's so good and stuff. I love him. But I feel like we're them in real life outside of the motorcycle uniform job.
Yeah. Yep.
That's the movie to make. It's Ponch and John not at work. Like, what goes down when these guys aren't at work?
Ponch and John alternate universe.
Yeah. What if
we're that's what it should be.
Ponch and John as centaurs.
And oh, yeah. Gone.
Yes.
That's it. We take the Chips theme, make it more of us. We are centaurs. We fucking still can get on the freeway at top speed. In the whole
Yeah, we can. Just buzzing through, you know, rush hour when everybody's just bumper to bumper and it's a parking lot. We're just riding through.
Yeah. Kind of like, what's that, cowboy, urban cowboy type shit where they're riding through the fucking city on pony during riding them through fucking Times Square or whatever.
Mm-hmm. I'll be writing to, what is that, Nopa container? Give me that. I just reach in, snatch it out of their convertible.
Yeah.
And just chug it.
What do you do about it?
I shotgun it and throw it down in the floorboard. Pussy. And I just take off. Oh my God.
Pussy!
Why don't we have CGI? If we had CGI capability, I would make this right now. We would make this a video series. Ponch John, Centaur Patrol.
God. But, oh, that's fucking nice.
Chips, bro. Centaur Highway Patrol. That would be us.
That's it. That's what we would be.
Damn it.
All the shows that I watched as a kid basically is what I learned I wanted to be as an adult, you know? Like, I was telling my lady the other day, you know, we were driving somewhere, and I was like, man, I just wish I had, like, an 18-wheeler where I can just drive this car up into it, and we can just hide out in, like, a little headquarters with computers and stuff, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Like Knight Rider, because he used to fucking drive, and he'd ride up into the back of that fuck. Dude, every time that car drove into that 18-wheeler trailer, I come in my little pants, bro. I couldn't get Dude, when that car would roll up in there and fucking Michael Knight would get out and that looked like a goddamn headquarters in there with computers and shit, and then some ladies just over there like, hello Michael, here's the breakdown, and then she'd hand him paperwork and just like, wow bro, this is the life, man.
Was there a Knight Rider theme song? I mean, there was. Let's see if I can find it. I gotta hear it.
Well, yeah, bro. Fucking Knight Rider.
Knight Rider theme song. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's it.
It was showtime in front of the TV crew when this song came on.
Yo,
this is like the actual 1982 synthesizer being played. Oh, the bass noise. There's this guy's just rocking it. Look at it.
Nice.
Oh, man, bro.
Fucking love Knight Rider, dude.
Fuck, dude.
Didn't even have to drive that car. But he would sometimes because he's David Hasselhoff, man. Michael sometimes had to drive it himself just to show what he could do.
Yeah.
Do you know what I like the best about David Hasselhoff as Michael in Knight Rider? What? His ability to wear a leather jacket that's two sizes too small and still be cool.
That's why I wear members only jackets one size too small. It's in dedication to Michael Knight.
Hell yeah. Like the sleeves stopped. Like 4 inches above the wrist bone, still fucking the coolest dude on TV. Come on.
You know why? Because he was the only dude with a watch that could talk to his fucking car. So if I'm him, why would I ever want to get in the way of that? You know what I mean? Yeah. Like this watch, come get me car. Like that's insanity back then, bro, in the 80s. And you know what's wild is that now you can do that. You can fucking talk in your Apple Watch or whatever in your car, your Tesla comes around.
Yeah.
But. Yeah, the fact that Michael ever pretended to drive that thing, and like, yeah, we know it's fucking Kit driving, bro, just because you're doing the hand motions. When I was a little kid, we used to go to Universal Studios. You know, I lived in L.A., and that was like our big trip or whatever. And we would go, and that's where it was all filmed.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So we would be able to see the whole fleet of them, like behind the scenes of the Knight Rider. You see, there's like 40 of those cars back there.
Really?
Yeah. It was like, you know, you'd see it. And this is here is a set of Knight Rider. And then you could sit. I sat in Kit's car and talked to Kit.
Kit would talk to you? Holy
Oh yeah.
Shit.
The car would talk. Hello. Like, you know, he'd fucking sit in and he would just, whatever. He had probably just programmed shit it said or whatever, but.
Hello, Michael.
It was sweet, bro. Hello, Michael. Yeah, that was fucking nice, bro. Kit had such a personality on him.
Yeah, he was like, he always had the one tone and he had the English accent, but he could be a real smart ass when he wanted to be.
Oh, dude. He was a smart ass, bro. And Kit was K-I-T-T.
Yeah. It's.
Kit stood for
something.
I think you could buy it for your car, bro.
Oh no. Are you serious?
You can a Knight Rider mini voice box display LED VU meter. Add to cart. Add to cart. Everybody fuck right off.
We got Jarrett.
Kit stood for Knight Industries 2000.
Knight Industries 2000.
Oh. Oh, I thought he said Knight in the Streets 2000.
So Knight Industries was owned by a rich. I remember now. It's coming back to me. There was a rich dude, right? And he got a hold of Michael, I think, because. Wasn't Michael like a fugitive or something? He was an outlaw. And I think they recruited him because of that. I don't remember. Some shit.
Yeah.
Dude, he used to get laid all the time.
Oh, that hair, that fucking red turtleneck, that jacket, the car, the watch, the walk.
Come
on. The guy was a big fucking dough ball of swagger.
Here we go.
All right. Might as well put on some music. All these weird gadgets, you think they'd give you a radio?
What would you like to hear?
What the hell was that?
By the way, the air sound.
Further information on Silicon Valley.
Oh, that was somebody else queuing in on Michael.
Is that the thing you were going to buy?
No. Here's the first time Kit talks.
Okay.
For God's sake, don't go quite so fast.
That's not him. Hold on.
But I got places to go. What the hell does that mean?
Okay, this is too long. Come on.
I heard you on the phone this morning.
This is from the actual show?
Yeah. Here's where he's giving him the car. The old white dude.
Okay.
Michael Knight? Michael Long is dead. Remember that.
Well, I don't know. That's too much, but.
See?
I don't know.
What it was. His name was Michael Long. And he was like a fugitive or something.
Oh.
And they erased his identity and he became Michael Knight because the owner of Kit, the rich guy, his last name was Knight.
Oh, okay.
These plots used to be now, so good.
Here's a car that plays the sounds of Kit. It's a little toy car. Man, I wish I had that car. I might have to buy that, bro.
You should buy the toy.
I'm telling you, don't understand right now as a kid. I mean, I'm sure kids aren't listening, so it's not like I'm having a breakthrough to a kid when I say, you don't understand another kid. But yeah, I mean, we had it fucking made, bro. TV.
It was so good then, man. So good. Like I like shows now, you know. I'm on my third episode of Sinner, by the way. I love that show. Mm-hmm. But it's different. I mean, we had these... Each episode, it wasn't serial, you know, it was episodic. Each episode stood on its own. It was just your favorite characters. You knew if you were watching the A-Team, you knew that they were going, you know what? It looks like, the Army got them. Looks like they're going to go to the stockade for the rest of their lives. Every episode. And then halfway through, they would escape. And then they would also not kill anybody. They would beat up all the bad guys, tie them up, and leave them for the authorities to arrest at the end, and then they would disappear. Yep. That would happen every episode. We knew the formula. We knew exactly what the layout was, and we didn't give a fuck because they did it awesome.
Hell no. And guess what? Every single time I thought they were done.
Every single time.
There's no way these dudes are getting loose.
I used to bawl.
You fucking know. Michael, next thing you know, Face becomes some old man, and then he slides into a fucking side door, and he's faking old walk, and then fucking Murdoch shows up, and then he's somebody else. He's dressed as a clown doing balloon animals at a fucking army general's kid's birthday party, and then they link up by the bathroom, and then a fucking vehicle that they welded a bunch of metal around and big fat guns on top. Mr. T comes in, boom, 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 just fucking breaking through fences, blasting up. No one gets shot. Get the guys, get the kid, fucking dip out. Everybody wins.
I used to sit and bawl. I would cry every episode because I thought this is it. This is the last episode. They're going to the stockade. And my dad would walk in like, what's wrong with you? I'd be like, Hannibal and them, they're going to the stockade forever this time. And he was like, you shut up. You know this happens every episode. I'm like, no, this is not this time, because this time they got the van. The van got a flat tire and they can't get away. And he's...
Remember when every once in a while it would end with a to be continued? What? The story extends to another episode.
When that happened, that was a huge deal. Like, it was like you would call your friends on the landline, and I could run halfway around the house with it because we had the real long cord from the phone.
I
would call my friends. I'm like, oh my god, did you see the Incredible Hulk carried over to a new episode? And they're like, what? Yeah, a new episode. They're like, it's never happened before. They're like, I know, it's crazy. It might blow my TV up. My TV doesn't know how to handle continued episodes.
It was a mind-blowing situation. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, we're little kids. We're mind-blown.
Yeah.
God, we didn't know what to do in a set to be continued. We didn't know what to do.
We were so much easier entertained. So much more easily entertained. Thank God. Now you got to you know what you got to pull off now to impress a kid and make him run through the house going crazy over his You got to fucking, you got to invent Baby Yoda to make people jump out. You got to invent a whole new character from an already epic movie trilogy in order to flip people out like that. Now, all we had to do was put to be continued across the screen and then not in the episode, carry it over till next week. And we lost our mind. God, we were easy.
Fuck, dude.
That was the golden age of television.
Fucking Fall Guy, Airwolf,
$6 Million Man. Dude, the $6 Million Man. But he fought Bigfoot. Like, his arch enemy was fucking Bigfoot. They would square off every 4 or 5 episodes they'd run across each other and fight it out. Fucking Bigfoot. God.
I want to tell this funny ass story. And this story I want to just mention, it happened this weekend, by the way. We haven't even really touched on how much fun we just fucking explored and had. Playing cornhole all weekend with the pros over in Florida, you know, getting on ESPN and doing our commentary. So when we were flying home, I knew my bag was over. Like, I have a great meter. I've traveled enough now. I'm like, oh, this is over 50 pounds, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And on the way there, I had to rearrange some stuff because I was 4 or 5 pounds over. Between my two suitcases and my backpack, I had to do some moving around. So I knew this time I was going to have the same issue. So I roll up to the counter. I even said it to the first lady who helped me put the sticker on. I go, I'm pretty sure my bag's overweight. I'm going to find out. We go, as I roll over to the lady behind the counter at Frontier Air, there's a lady next to me going bonkers on these people. Oh, you want me to fucking throw my clothes away? You want to charge me $140 for some clothes? I mean, we're talking going ham on them. I'll put these clothes over there. You want me to move my shit around? That one's under. It shouldn't matter. Like, she's fucking going off. The dude is just, you could tell the dude has just succumbed. Like, he's just back letting it all fly. Little kids running around. It was like she was kind of like one of the miserable older ladies. She wasn't like old, but she was getting there. And, you know,
she hates her life. Her husband's fucking around. For the eighth time. That.
He might even have a cock and balls anymore. He could be like one of the Greyjoys with nothing. And so I am standing almost shoulder to shoulder with this lady while she's just going ham on this lady but at Frontier Air. And while she's over here fucking with her bags, I look down at my bag. I'm at 58 pounds. I'm 8 pounds over. I got these goddamn mic stands in there and shit. You know, I got cornhole bags. And I just kind of block my skin because I was waiting for this bitch to turn and go, he's got a 58 pound bag. And then I would have been, that's when now we got a problem, bitch. You miss, now you're fucking with me. What about yourself, ho? And so my lady was so like looking over at them so much, like worried about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't even give a flying fuck about my bag. She didn't even look how much it weighed. Nothing. Put the sticker on, dippity, hip, hip, skip, scop, scoop, right to the fucking thing. I looked over at them while they kept arguing. I dipped to security.
Nice. She got you off scot-free.
And I'm telling you, it's also that when it comes to, you don't fuck with the flight gods, the travel gods. You know what I mean? People who tried to fucking strong arm their way through the airport. And you know what? That wasn't the end of her. I get to security. I got clear, right? So when I go to the airport, if it has clear, see you later. It's the fastest shit in the world. Mm-hmm. You just go in and I put my eyes in there or a thumbprint. They go, okay, bing, bang, boom. They got their own little area right to the guy. You don't even fucking have to show them your ID. You just scan your ticket and go just right to the little, you know, car wash for bags.
Mm-hmm.
And the lady's at the fucking, now we're at the security line and she's throwing a fit. Oh, well, the kid doesn't have, because she didn't want to go in the x-ray machine, right? They don't, I guess you don't want everybody to see them cheeseburgers, right? And she is now going bonkers on security, bro. I was just like, this lady is miserable, man. I mean, yelling at security. I couldn't. She's like, oh, well, only one person per toddler. Who made up that rule? Like, just
Jesus,
going off on their whole bitch ruling system, bro. It was insane. I just hadn't seen anybody. First of all, I was happy because she saved me $100 and or time of having to switch things around and weigh it.
Oh, yeah. Also, but like, I feel like when you fuck, like you're just asking for your luggage to be sent to fucking Hawaii, you know, when that happened. Like, that's what I would do. I would just let her and shake my head, let her abuse me as the fucking airline employee. Yep. I'm a cocksucker. Yep. We're the worst. Blah, blah, blah. And as soon as I took that bag, I would fucking change that tag, put that on the flight to Hawaii and fucking send your shit halfway across the world, baby.
Peace, hoe.
Good luck. Yeah, 65 pounds of your bag is going to Honolulu.
I just can't imagine that dude's life having to deal with that level of misery.
That's the only way
like I my can do lady,
with this, fuck with people back, right?
Yeah, you couldn't pay my girlfriend. You could pay my fiance $100,000 to do that. Like, you couldn't say, babe, here's $100,000 cash. Go make a fucking scene here and go. Now, she'll do it at home all day. She'll get in my face real quick, but never, you know, she'll make a scene to me, but never in a million years will she ever make even remotely close to that. Not only that level once, but several times throughout the airport experience.
I had an ex-wife like that. God damn it. Like, if she'd run her credit card through and it wouldn't work or whatever, start a big fucking scene every time. It's like, hey, this is nobody's fucking fault. The thing won't read the card. You got to make it. You got to make it big. There's fucking $5,000 in there. There's no fire. Who gives a fuck? The card reader's not working, dude. Like, it's nobody's fault. Like, this is just technology not working.
Yeah.
That 16-year-old kid can do nothing for you, and either can their 24-year-old manager that you're yelling for. Just fucking get a different card or put this shit back and come back a different day. What the fuck? But would throw a fit. I would just walk out. I would just walk out to the car and just wait. Like, I can't be here to witness this.
No.
Mm.
Can't, but, bro. That's a rough look.
But we touched on this weekend. Karma. Oh, it's way back karma. We touched on this weekend. You fucking crushed it on ESPN too. Going to be part of those broadcasts and talking to the celebs after the Super Bowl 2 was over, which was awesome. And then we told this at the Monday morning coffee session on Patreon this morning, but I feel like these people deserve it as well. So we went to eat with Chris Lytle, our boy, and some of the other people involved in the bare knuckle fight, that was happening on Saturday. We went out to eat with them Friday at Hibachi, by the way, first time I'd done Hibachi since COVID.
Oh yeah, it felt good to be back, dude.
It was fucking amazing. Like, you and I loved the down sake, so we were hitting the sake. It was great. And then Lido gets us two free tickets and right up ringside. Like, literally.
The problem was, though, right? Remember, the problem was that we were already doing the ESPN thing, didn't even end till 10 o'clock. This place was 30 minutes away and the fight started at 9.
Right. So we knew we were going to only catch the second half of fights in it. The second half of fights.
Yeah.
Hoping we catch most of the main card. But then we couldn't get an Uber for like an hour and a half because we forgot Super Bowl was only 40 minutes from there. So everybody that drives an Uber or Lyft is in Tampa Bay running people around that are there for Super Bowl at a fucking increased rate. It's definitely peak pricing. So we finally get there. We run just so, because we knew that Chris Lieben had just knocked his dude out in like 20 seconds.
Because some beastie-ass thugs told us in the parking lot.
Yeah.
Because they were leaving, and we were sprinting. And they were like, have we missed a Lieben fight? And they're like, oh, he just knocked the motherfucker out. We're like, damn.
Damn.
And then we got in. So go ahead.
So we knew we had to catch Paige VanZant. Was the other big fight. We're running. We're like, oh, we only got two more fights left. And we run around. Somebody tells us directions. So we run around to where we got to go in, and there's a 90-some-year-old lady working the door.
Well, the box office had closed, so they gave the remaining tickets to a lady that was working, you know, one of the volunteer security ladies.
Yeah.
Or maybe just like, you know, part-time, and she sits there and scans your tickets when you come in.
Yeah, lovely lady. She's evidently, every bit of 90. And she's just sitting there with her little old sweet self with the stack of tickets that, you know, people had held. And Sean was like, hey, my name's Sean Latham. We're supposed to have two tickets here to get in, whatever. And it takes her forever to go through the stack that she has of envelopes.
We have Ramsey and Johnson Smith.
My leg was bouncing. I was like, oh my God, just fucking hurry up, lady. Hurry up, lady. We're going to get in there. We're going to miss the fight. And finally she gets to the end and she's like, oh, I don't see one here for Sean Latham. And I was like, oh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? This is totally Chris Lytle. It would be totally like him to forget to tell anybody out there to hold us two tickets. So I'm like, can I see him again? Can we go through him one more time? She gets to like the third one. Okay, Johnson, Smith, Ludwig, that's me. Oh, he put him in my name. There's two tickets?
Yeah.
She's like, yeah. And I'm like, oh, okay, those are mine. She goes, oh, these are yours? This is you? Yeah, that's me. Are you sure this is you? Yep, that's me. Two of us. See, there's two of us. Okay, here. And she gives us a ticket to go run inside.
And then he had his front seats, but these tickets were section 227, which ended up being really good.
Really,
and
even
we ended
better.
Up kind of sitting where we wanted. I don't know if they were great, but we ended up, you know, there was like, you know, they could only allow so many people in there. So there was some room. We just sat next to a couple of cool dudes.
Yeah.
And just started watching them fights, bro.
We were at the perfect ring level, because that second tier's ring level right in the front. And we were close. Now, I will say Chris Lytle did hold us two spots. There was two chairs right against the ring. We were right by the announcers with our names on them, but he just forgot to tell anybody to let us the fuck in. So, yeah, that's Chris Lytle.
We watched the last two fights. Fucking gnarly. Both went five rounds of just banging it like a professional street fight. And then we go down, we say what up to Lytle, give him a hug, say thanks, fucking bing, bang, boom. We sat outside for another 45, wait for an Uber. Like, we had one beer when we walked in, and that was it. And then we fucking dipped out. We sat there, waited, went home. Went to sleep, woke up, and fucking filmed for DraftKings.
Yeah. Oh, it was awesome.
Doing a commentary, time, playing Cornell. They were long days, but so much fun. It's like, we're just doing what we want. Like, long I want to have a few beers. I want to talk on camera. I want to talk behind camera. I don't want to play cornhole. And that's it.
I mean, this is what the beautiful thing. You had been around this, you know, these people before. I hadn't. And can I tell you how much I love a professional sport where everybody, including the people competing, are just drinking all the time? Not like lush drinking, just sipping on cold ones. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
At a controlled
sipping space. On a cold one.
Yeah, it's just like, instead of grabbing a bottle of water and taking a little sip, you know, right before you play, it's a Bud Light. Like, I feel like I fucking love this sport, dude.
Not one person was drunk in there. Not one.
No. This is literally like when you're in the backyard throwing bags, you sip on a cold one. Why you fucking throw bags? What everybody does. And let's take that to the professional level. That doesn't change. And I fucking love it. Love it. I mean, even when they were at ESPN, they couldn't show the labels or whatever, but they had beers.
Yeah, and their cups. Cool. Like they just have the whatever, the cup you might put water in and go to the gym with or whatever. Yeah. But it's just beer.
So cool.
Beers and fucking seltzers, bro. It's like you just kind of have a few throughout the day while you're playing.
Mm-hmm. Great time. Great time. And good people.
It was so much fun. We did some live cooking, we did some live cornhole on the ESPN set. Now, just so everybody's clear, if you didn't see on social media, I am the number one cornhole player on this podcast. That doesn't mean it's going to be forever. It just means right now, for the national event, I'm the champ.
Right now, it was definite. I mean, I think we played four games once we started the challenge. We split the day before, 2-2.
Yeah.
And then we were like, okay, we got our practice out of the way. Let's fucking go legit. Let's have a title. We created a little title between us and you fucking smoked me within four. I don't even think I even got to like over 13 points in any of the games.
Now, I'm not trying to rub it in, but I did beat you one game 21-0. Now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It is what it is. But no, the other ones are much closer than that one. I was just
I still don't think I got over 13 on any fucking game. I mean, it was incredible.
I've been putting in a lot more work than you. This last couple of years, I'd say the last year, I had kind of some time off when I first moved to New York because, I'd play my lady's house and shit when I was there on the weekends. But, and I would practice on my airmail box in my apartment in New York. But, not since I moved out. They started playing all the time out here at the house. And then me and my girl's family, like her brother, her son's really good. Her brother's wife, we play couples off a lot. We'll have little tournaments and shit. So nice. We play a lot at the house. That's why. And I'm up on you because I probably got 30 or 40 sets of bags. I'd say I got about at least 10 sets of bags.
Maybe
12 sets.
I got to get me a cornhole set. I haven't really played on a board since we worked with Pat.
Yeah.
Until we got there. But I do have the airmail thing, and we played that a lot during the 3 weeks you were here, we were building the shed. We played that almost every night. So then it was coming back. But I love it. I love it. I just want to play all the time now. So I'm going to order a real set from allcornhole.com, right? Is that what it is?
Yeah, allcornhole.com.
Yeah. I play
cornhole and all cornhole.
Yeah. I'm only getting regulation bags and boards from now on. Like I'm not playing with – because if you don't, then you're really screwed when you play on really good boards with really good bags because you're not used to the shit,
Yeah. So. I ordered – well, one of the pros that you met, Joseph Adcock, he's with Jersey Shore Cornhole because cornhole is taking the fuck over. If you guys want to see how popular it is, just go type in cornhole in the Facebook search bar.
Dude, it's
– or in the groups for sure. It could be anywhere from 200 to 10,000 in groups all over the country.
I mean, it's so big, and the people are all incredibly cool and weird.
Every last one of them.
Weird and wonderful. And I mean, it's all types, you know what I mean? Like quiet kind of weird dudes, but they're awesome. And then you got real loud, rambunctious, like, your uncle at the barbecue type dude. And he's awesome. I just love it. I just love it. I can't get it.
Hey, you know what? And the age bracket, there's one kid who's 10 years old and he's a pro.
Yeah.
He's so good and he goes enough to get enough points to qualify as a pro. And then you have guys that are like the guy who won the first fucking singles championships of the year was like, he's like 58 or 65 or something.
I love it.
Damon Dennis.
Love it.
He's a guy. If you ever seen the viral clip, you want me to knock that one off? And then he throws a bag where he knocks one bag off the back of his opponent and then he sinks it in the hole, his bag for a 4-point play.
That's it.
That's him. Yeah. Oh, you want me to knock that one off? And then he fucking hits it. The Damon Dennis shot. That thing I tweeted, they tweeted it and then I retweeted it with a quote tweet and then it fucking hits at Barstool people and then it just went fucking bananas.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
It's good stuff. It's good sport. It's so much fun. We got Born Knuckle in. You know, hopefully we're doing stuff with them. Hopefully we're doing stuff with the ACL. And, you know, we're blowing up shit. We're fucking that race car. We're just trying to enjoy our life and just bring you guys some stuff that's just unique and not anybody else is doing. That's
I think our booker is going to coordinate setting up comedy shows at the city that the Cornhole Nationals are happening. The Pro Nationals are happening every four or five of those that are left this year. Hopefully,
three
we'll
more
be there.
Big ones.
Yeah,
four big ones left, and we're going to set up shows the Thursday night before these weekends. And you know, we got a little something up our sleeve, and we're it's going to be fun, dude. Once we went through it with our one for one weekend of just kind of winging it and doing our thing, and then let our ideas start to sink in, it's going to be fucking gnar. It's going to be gnar.
Be ready for it. Other cool shit coming too. Travel adventure type shit. We know we're just going to start creating a bucket list. We're not getting any younger, and we're going to go knock out that bucket list and record everything. Everything we ever wanted to do, we're doing it.
Yeah, that's it. That's what we're doing. That's what we're going to do.
All right, bro.
And then the money will start rolling in, and then we're going to have our own fucking place like Pat, you know? And then we're going to have our own content factory.
That's right.
And we're going to. And then Jared will get paid full time and he can move.
Go here. Yeah, Jared's awesome. We got to get him full time on board. So I don't know what job he got now, Jared. Hopefully you like it, but it's a piece of shit job compared to working full time for us. So
that's for sure. Yeah.
don't quit the job just yet, Jared.
Yeah, don't quit until we tell you. But.
No plans, dude.
All right, guys. I'm about to shit my pants, so I'm going to go make that happen.
Awesome, man. Hey, appreciate you guys, man. I'll talk to you guys soon.
All right. Love you guys. Yeah.